It's good to see you once again today. We had a lovely evening last night, the afternoon tea party, and there are some exciting things happening this week as well. It'd be great to see you. Tonight we're meeting on Zoom at 6 o'clock for our communion service. On Tuesday, there's an arty party in Clwponti. I'm sure it'll be good fun for the younger children at 5:30, Impact Youth at 6:45. Then prayer meeting this evening, this week, will be on Thursday, not on Wednesday. Mulligator will be joining us from Ethiopia, a special guest visitor. He is a pastor of pastors in the country there. He's a trainer of leaders, used wonderfully by God to plant many churches. He'll be joining us 7 o'clock on Thursday evening. Do come along to that. And then next Sunday, in the morning, Arnold Morgan, pastor of Waterfront Church in Swansea, will be preparing a service for us on YouTube. And then in the evening, Alan Davey will be joining us on Zoom from Bordeaux. A good friend of the church, and we've got strong contacts with Alan and his wife Pat, and he will be joining us to give an update about his work out there and to bring us a message from God's word. So there's a lot of exciting things happening in the next few days. Let's pray that God will be exalted and that his name will be preached and proclaimed, and that more and more people might worship and know our Saviour. Well, let's continue to worship our God with our next hymn.
Gift of love and righteousness.
We're going to have a reading now from God's Word. Dawn is going to read from Hebrews chapter 7. Thanks, Dawn, for sending the video. Just to remind you of the context, we're looking at Melchizedek, and the author to the Hebrews mentions Melchizedek for a couple of reasons. First of all, because of the connections between Melchizedek and Jesus, he sees in Melchizedek a type, a pattern of Jesus, the King of Righteousness, the King of Peace, you might remember last week. And also, the Jewish people would have had a problem, and the Hebrews receiving this letter had a problem with Jesus. You see, the priest who could lead people in the presence of God and who could offer sacrifices had to be from the tribe of Levi. He had to be a Levite, a Levitical priest. But Jesus is from the line of Judah, from a different tribe. And so how can Jesus be a priest? And we'll see how the connection with Melchizedek helps us to respond to that. So we're going to see in this passage how Jesus is the great and perfect high priest and how he is our Saviour who can take away our sins and lead us into the presence of God the Father.
Hebrews chapter 7, verses 11 to 28. Jesus like Melchizedek. If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, from the basis of it the law was given to the people, why was there still a need for another priest to come? One in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron. For when there is a change of the priesthood, there must also be a change of the law. He of whom these things are said belonged to a different tribe, and no one from our tribe has ever served at the altar. For it is clear that our law descended from Judah, and in regard to that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. And what we have said is even more clear. If another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry, but on the basis of the power of an indestructible life. For it is declared, you were a priest forever, in the order of Melchizedek. The former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless. For the law made nothing perfect, and a better hope is introduced, by which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath. Others became priests without any oath, but he became a priest with an oath when God said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. Because of this oath, Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. Now there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all, when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men who are weak, but the oath which came after the law appointed the Son, who has been made perfect forever. Amen.
At the heart of every religion are some basic and fundamental questions. Who is God? What is he like? Can we know him? Can we have a relationship with him? And what about ourselves? What are we like? Who are we? What about sin? Can we be forgiven? Can we have a relationship with God and be accepted by him? Are these questions at the heart of every religion? And I guess because these questions have been asked by most cultures throughout human history, it points to the very existence of God. It reminds us that we have been created in the image of God, that at the heart of every person, there is an awareness of God. A God-shaped void, if you like. Romans 1 teaches us this, that we might suppress this truth, we might deny it, but we are all aware that God is there. But the multiplicity of religion and all these various faiths and the fact that they have opposing views and contradictory views also points to the sin in the heart of all people. And that we are confused, that we're lost. We don't really know who God is or what he is like. And this is a wonderful message of Christianity. The good news of Jesus is that he is Emmanuel, God with us. He described himself as the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life, he said. Everyone who has seen me has seen the Father. He is the image of the invisible God. He makes the God who is unseen, seen. He is no longer an unknown God. You look at Jesus and you can see who God is, and you read in the Bible about this wonderful God. And so we no longer need to be in darkness. We no longer need to be confused. God has revealed himself to this world. Another question often asked by religions, of course, was, how can we be better people? How can we live better lives? How can we attain a higher level of spirituality? How can we be better people, more godly, more holy? Is it possible to be perfect and righteous, to be absolutely holy? And the people that the author to the Hebrews was writing to were starting to ask these questions. And they were looking back to the sacrificial system, and this seemed to be their answer, that to be holy, to be righteous, what we need to do is to reinstate the Levitical priesthood, to carry on with the Old Testament sacrifices. I'm sure you remember the context of the book of Hebrews. These are Christians, second, third generation Christians. Their parents, grandparents were of a Jewish background, and they had become Christians. They had realized that Jesus is the Messiah, the one promised in the Old Testament, the one who is the fulfillment of all of the Old Testament. So their parents and grandparents had trusted in the Lord Jesus as their Saviour. But these Christians are now starting to look back to the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures, and they're starting to long for these traditions. They're starting to long for these teachings and the customs. They're elevating people like Abram and Moses to the same level as Jesus, and they are pulling Jesus down to their level. And it seems that one other thing they did was to elevate the Old Testament sacrificial system, that they thought that they could be holy and perfect, that their sins could be dealt with by looking to these Old Testament sacrifices, reinstating the Levitical priests, and by offering these sacrifices once again. And in doing this, they were neglecting the gospel. They were neglecting Jesus, his death and resurrection. And their focus was now on the sacrifices. And the author writes to them to encourage them to stop doing this, because there is a far better hope, that the Lord Jesus and the gospel is far more glorious and far more profound and far better. These people have fallen into the same trap that people have fallen to throughout history. See, we're all proud and we all have an ego, and we want to be able to help ourselves. We want to be able to save ourselves, to have a part in our own salvation. We don't want to have to depend on others. We don't want to be a charity case. We want to help and save ourselves. And so if we can do something, then we will feel better about ourselves. If we can somehow do enough good deeds to earn our salvation, if we can live a good enough life to be accepted by God, if we can follow certain rituals or ceremonies or give enough sacrifices or offerings, well, then we'll feel better about ourselves, and surely then that'll be better. But actually, they've misunderstood just how sinful we are and how far we've fallen from the glory of God. And the first thing I want to consider today is the things that cannot save us. What are the things which cannot make us righteous or perfect? Ultimately, no human system will be able to save us. No amount of effort or religiosity, rituals or ceremonies can make us perfect or righteous. No system that depends on sinful people will be successful. The five pillars of Islam, for example, people can keep those regulations and follow the requirements, but they will still be sinners at the end of the day. And they will still have to give an account before God for the things that they've done. And they will have fallen short, and all that they've done will not outweigh or outbalance the sin in their hearts and in their lives. Catholic rituals, the confession, the liturgy, the various indulgences or mass, these things will not outweigh the sin in our heart. You might be baptized, you might be confirmed in a church, you might become a church member, you might go to church or to chapel every week, and yet that in itself won't make you perfect or righteous. Those things in themselves cannot save you. You can try to do all sorts of different good deeds, acts of kindness, acts of charity, spiritual devotion and acts of spiritual devotion, and yet even those things will not be enough. It will be an endless pursuit. You will never reach holiness. You will never reach perfection or righteousness. There will always be more sin in you. And you will always have to give an account to God for the things that you've done. They say about academics that the more they learn, the more they understand, the more they realise how little they know and understand. And someone perhaps is in a sixth form or start off in college, they think, oh, I have all the answers, I'm an expert in this area, in this subject. But the more they study, the more they learn, the more they realise how much more there is to learn and understand. And it's true about a holy life, that the more you try to live a holy life, the more you realise how unholy you are. You perhaps deal with one issue, and then you realise that there's a whole other issue that you haven't dealt with. And maybe you're able to deal with some of the outward problems, but you start to notice then your words, or your attitudes, your thoughts and your plots and schemes. And you realise that actually perfection, holiness is beyond you. That we cannot reach that level, we cannot reach holiness. That God's holiness is far more glorious and far more awesome than we can begin to imagine. That's how I first became a Christian, when I realised that I'd fallen short of the glory of God. And there was nothing I could do to make myself good enough or holy or righteous. Every human effort that depends on us will fail. We cannot save ourselves. We cannot help ourselves. And this ultimately is a problem with the sacrificial system. As the author to the Hebrew points out in this passage, Hebrews 7 verses 11 to the end of chapter 7, this Levitical priesthood could not give us perfection. Actually, he says that this former regulation is weak and useless. Strong words to describe the Old Testament sacrificial system. Weak and useless in that it cannot save, it cannot remove our sins in itself. The priests were ineffective because they died. Death prevented them from continuing in office. And they were sinners. Verse 27 says that they needed to offer sacrifices day after day for their sin. Ultimately, verse 28 says that they were weak. They were limited by their own sin, by their own mortality. And so really they couldn't save people. They couldn't save the world, and what they sacrificed were limited as well, because bulls and goats cannot save anyone. And the whole point of the Old Testament sacrificial system was not actually to save people, but to point people to the ultimate Saviour. The whole point of the Old Testament sacrificial system, and what made it effective, what made it glorious, was that it pointed to the ultimate priest and to the ultimate sacrifice and the ultimate Saviour. Someone might go in a flight simulator and they might fly a plane in that simulator, and they might cross the Atlantic, and they might take controls of the steering of that plane, and they might feel as if they are flying, but they cannot say that they've flown a plane. They cannot say that they've crossed the Atlantic. They've only been in a copy, a template, a simulator. And in the same way, the Old Testament priests were not the final product. The actual sacrifices They're not in themselves save. In themselves, they were weak and useless because they were of this world and they were limited by sin, limited by death, by mortality and immorality. And so these priests could not save, and the sacrifices could not take away the sins of the world. The point I'm trying to make here really is that if we try to depend on people for salvation, if we try to depend on our own efforts or our own religiosity, ritual ceremonies or traditions or customs, if we try to rely on our own good works, we will always fall short because we are sinners and our efforts will always fall short. Muhammad was a sinner. Buddha was a sinner. Gandhi was a sinner. And within the Christian tradition, Martin Luther King was a sinner, as was Martin Luther before him and Calvin. All of these people who are presented, they're all sinners. Therapists and counsellors, they are sinners. And we are sinners. And so if we place our faith in people, if we place our faith in princes or in heroes or in celebrities or in philosophers, we will always fall short. And if we place our faith in religious ceremonies, we will always fall short. The remarkable thing about the Old Testament, as we are told here in verse 11, is that it actually suggested this, that the Old Testament itself showed that the answer was not the Levitical priesthood, but that there was a need for a greater priest. So this is what's said in verse 11. If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, why was there still need for another priest to come, one in the order of Melchizedek? Now it gets complicated here. Now hopefully you can follow. I remember what I said, this is solid food. This is quite complex. Hopefully you can follow the argument here. These people in the book of Hebrews, at the time of it was written, they were elevating the Levitical priesthood. This is what's needed. We need to return to these sacrifices. We need to reinstate these priests. They were elevating this priesthood. And the author says, actually, the Old Testament itself said that a greater priest was needed. In Psalm 110, it points forward to a priest who would be in the order of Melchizedek. He would not be in the line of Levi. He would not be a Levitical priest. But he would be from a different order altogether. See, the problem with Jesus is that he was not in the line of Levi. I want to consider who can save. I want to consider now who's able to make us righteous and perfect. And the answer is clear. It is Jesus. But from the perspective of the people who read or who received this book, Jesus was a problem because he was not a Levite. He was not of the tribe of Levi. As verse 14 says, it is clear that our Lord descended from Judah. He was in the line of Judah. He was from the tribe of Judah, not from the line of Levi. And in that regard, that tribe Moses said nothing about priests. Now we remember the emphasis in the book of Leviticus and in the book of Exodus was that it was only a Levite who could lead people in the presence of God. It is only a Levite who could offer a sacrifice for our sins. It is only a Levite who could give us peace with God. And so the problem we have here is, how can Jesus be our Saviour? How can he take away our sins if he's not a Levite, if he's not from that priesthood? Well, Melchizedek existed before Levi. And he lived before Levi was born, and he lived before Aaron was born, and he lived before the Levitical priesthood was established. He appears in Genesis 14 before the sacrificial system was established. And we're told here in verse 15 and verse 16 that he became a priest, not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry. He didn't become a priest because he was in the line of anyone or because he followed in some sort of genealogy. He became a priest because of the power of an indestructible life. And in the context of Melchizedek, I'm sure it's to do with the fact that he was a holy and righteous and godly man. And so God appointed him as a priest. Nothing to do with his lineage, nothing to do with his background, because he lived a holy and godly life. And so Melchizedek shows that it is possible to be a priest without being from the tribe of Levi. And the Lord Jesus, of course, was from the line of Judah. And so the author is trying to remove that obstacle. The Lord Jesus can be the perfect priest, and he can be our Saviour, and he can remove our sin because of an indestructible life. Because he lived a perfect and holy and righteous life. Melchizedek would have sinned. He was a sinner. He wasn't absolutely holy. But the Lord Jesus lived an absolutely perfect and holy life, without sin at all. And indestructible life as well, in the sense that in his divine nature, he was eternal. The Son of God existed forever, and he became a human being. And now, as the God-man, he lives forever. And so the Lord Jesus is qualified to be our Saviour, and he's the one who can make us perfect. He's the one who can make us righteous, because he is the perfect priest who's lived a holy and righteous life. And it says here in verse 24, Jesus lives forever. He has a permanent priesthood. And it says in verse 26 and 27, that he is holy and blameless and pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens, and he does not need to offer sacrifices for his own sins. What makes Jesus the perfect Saviour? How is Jesus able to take away our sins? How is Jesus able to make us perfect and holy? Well, he's the one appointed by God. We're told this in chapter 5. Verse 4, this is a priest, this is a Saviour appointed by God the Father himself. And he is holy and righteous. He does not have to give an offering for his own sin. He does not require a sacrifice to take away his own sins. He is righteous and perfect himself. And so he is fully qualified to give his own life as the perfect sacrifice to take away the sins of the world. And he is everlasting. He lives forever. And so he can intercede on the behalf of all of his people, those who would be born hundreds, thousands of years later. He is the Son of God. And so he's able to die for the sins of the world. He is a Son of God. And so he can intercede in heaven for his people. And he is a righteous Son of God who is able to give his life for our sakes. How can we be forgiven? How can we be made perfect and righteous? This is a question we are discussing today. We cannot be made perfect and righteous by our own efforts, or by trusting our own abilities, or thinking that somehow our religious efforts will save us, because we will always fall short. There is only one Saviour. There's only one place we can look for salvation. And it is in the one sent by God the Father, the perfect priest, the perfect Saviour, the Lord Jesus. He is from everlasting to everlasting. He lives forever. And like any other priest or leader, he is eternal and everlasting. And unlike any other person, he has lived a perfect and righteous and sinless life. No accusations can be made against him, no hypocrisy. And so he can take away the sins of the world. The righteous one can take on the sins of the unrighteous ones and die in their place. And he lives forever in eternity in heaven. And so he can intercede for us and pray for our salvation and forgiveness. Where do we look? Well, we look to the Saviour sent by God himself. And when we look to him, we will know true salvation. When we look to him, we will know that our sins have been taken away once and for all. And so we're told here that he is the guarantee of a better covenant, and he is a better hope by which we draw near to God. This is why the Christian message is so wonderful. This is why the good news of Jesus is so great. Because by trusting in Jesus, by placing our faith in him, we can be made perfect and righteous in the eyes of God. We can be considered righteous by God himself. And because of that, we can draw near to God himself, and we can have a perfect relationship with a God who is there. And this will not fail. And this will never fall short. And this will never prove inadequate or insufficient. If you trust in Jesus, you will know forgiveness, a perfect relationship with God, and everlasting life and hope. And so stop looking for hope in this life. Stop looking for hope in people or in your efforts. Look to Jesus. Look to him. Place your faith in him, and you will have a better hope and an everlasting promise of life and the presence of God. Jesus lives forever. He has a permanent priesthood. He is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. We thank you that we have a wonderful priest. We thank you that through the Lord Jesus we can come into your presence and draw near to God. Might we not look to our own efforts? Might we not look to our own abilities? Salvation belongs to the Lord. And we thank you for sending your Son to be the Saviour of the world. Would we fix our eyes upon him for our eternal salvation, comfort and joy, and for your glory. In Jesus' name, Amen.